Hello, Toolboxers. Welcome to episode 332. A great interview, did. It's a backlog one from with Lauren Egan. It was interesting. This interview was actually about a year ago. It was actually recorded. It's still relevant, but it was one of the impetus of me thinking about expanding my firm from the information she said to the guidance she gave in it. So it's very special, very helpful. It really changed my business structure. This interview with Ruby Powers and a couple of other people really opened my mind from going to a solo to expanding and how they did it. So it's really good to listen to. Again, Lauren, thanks so much. I'm sorry for the delay in getting this out, but better late than never. Having said that, we also have the Toolbox training course out there. We're doing a special where we're combining not only our marriage green card course, it's 10, 12 hours of detailed video of how to do a marriage green card case, family-based, general to it, admissibility, constant processing, adjustment of status, going through the statute, learning the hardcore lawyering from the CFR, the INA, memos, and just breaking it down so you know it better than anyone else. We're attaching the raw footage of our 01 seminar, the best 01 attorneys practically in the country, in one place, one day, morning to night. We recorded, and unfortunately you missed the great dinner we had afterwards, but the recording of the event there, a lot of inside information that you won't find anywhere else, one-on-one. It's just spectacular. We're doing a combo 2-for-1 deal, so you don't have to buy the 01 separately. If you're getting into immigration law, you're already doing immigration law, you want to learn more and get into it. Because a lot of our students are people in practice for 10 years, but they know how hardcore I like to get into things, and also the community that's developed around these videos, because we have a community page and private office hours that come with it. And you just become part of the network. So a lot of it is you're buying friends. You buy this and you get closer with me and my group, and there's all sorts of positive stuff that come from that. Just leave it at that. I don't want to make promises bigger, but it's even bigger than that, really. But just join, hit me up, info@immigrationlawyerstoolbox.com is a place to go. The following is not intended for individual legal guidance, consult with an immigration attorney, but you all know that already. Enjoy. Hi, Lauren. Thank you so much for coming on the show. It's good to meet you.
Good to meet you too.
So let's start about your background a little bit. Where are you from and how did you get involved with immigration law?
Yeah, I'm from the Pacific Northwest, Seattle area, and I actually grew up in a small town with barely any immigrants. But when I was in middle school, an immigrant family moved to our town and my teacher kind of paired me up with the girl who was joining our school. And that was my first exposure really to immigration, but I loved it. And I loved talking to her and helping her learn a little English, and she helped me learn a little Spanish. And from then on, I started learning more and more Spanish. I eventually decided to move abroad to Mexico to become fully fluent. And I just really realized I wanted to work with the immigrant community. So I looked at different career options and settled on immigration law.
And how long have you been a practicing attorney?
Since 2011. So I guess we're just over 12 years now.
Wow. And I'm going to get to your firm actually right now, like how tremendous the growth was. I think when we first scheduled this, I looked at your website. I think you had like less attorneys. I look right now, you have like 10 attorneys in the firm. Really, am I remembering correctly? There were less like a month or two ago?
There were, but we also did just update our website. So probably when you looked at it, we were just in like the final phases of redoing the website. So we weren't making many updates to the old version. But yeah, actually, so... My firm is based in the DC area. In 2020, you know, everything shut down for COVID. We had just bought a house on the West Coast. So we moved and kind of transformed the firm to be fully remote. And it really took off. Like, I changed my marketing strategy. I changed how we interacted with clients. And in around 6 months in 2020, we went from 5 employees to 50 employees.
Wow.
Yeah, it was insane. And now we are closer, we're around 80. It, you know, every day I feel like it changes a little bit. Did we hire somebody new? Or are we letting someone go? You know, but we're at around 80 employees right now and 10 attorneys.
Okay, there's so much to go there. I guess I'll start with the first thing. What is the strategy that you changed that made a difference?
The biggest thing was really changing our marketing to be nationwide. So I've always done a lot of social media marketing. That's how I would say I grew my firm. I was one of the first attorneys doing Facebook Lives and being on social media a lot. And so it grew a lot that way. And I would do ads and things like that in very targeted areas. I had an office in the Seattle area and I had the office in DC. So that's where I was targeting. But once, you know, we went fully remote, we started targeting a lot of different cities. So we looked at cities with high immigrant populations. And we also looked at cities with higher immigrant populations, but with less access to attorneys. Yeah. And so we started targeting those different cities on social media, on Google ads, things like that. And it made a huge difference.
What kind of cases, I guess, what are the biggest types of cases that you handle with most volume?
Yeah, well, we just opened a business immigration department, but prior to that, we did almost exclusively family-based and humanitarian. So a lot of VAWA cases, a lot of T-Visa cases, and that's also part of why we grew so much is I really dove this just prior to COVID, I started diving into the strategies behind VAWA and how to use it for a broader group of people rather than just women. But okay, can we apply it to men? Can we apply it to children, parents of US citizens? And that also allowed us to reach a wider audience.
Interesting. I was looking at stats over the last 10 years, and over the last 3 years, there's been like an exponential growth in VAWA filings. Yeah. There's a lot that goes on that we all know about the community about VAWA filing stuff like that, but it's there and a lot of people are filing it. And I mean, I bet the delay, so I was looking at the stats, there's a strong growth in filings, but the approval rate stays the same, which means there's a huge backlog developing because it's not like they're approving more, not denying more. It's just like everything, the government's staying the same as how they're processing it, but the filings are going up. So I'm sure you're probably seeing delays in that. So
yeah, it's taking about 3 years right now, which is, but the good thing is if you can file your VAWA concurrently with the I-485, you can also file for an I-765 and I-131. So they can get their work and travel permit in the meantime, which for most of our clients who have been the victim of some type of domestic violence or assault or something, like that's a big deal for them to have some sort of document in their hand.
Now, how are you, one thing you mentioned too, before I get the next, you say you change your interaction with clients. Is that just going more digital than in person, or is there other kind of stuff that you?
Yeah, going more digital than in person. And then we built out our team so that the touch points are not, I guess prior when it was a smaller group, like they would have a lot more attorney interaction because it was me with just a few assistants or paralegals. And now we have a much larger staff and we have people trained in mental health, counseling, psychology, things like that, that we purposefully put on our staff in those roles that are going to interact a lot with our clients. So not only is it completely virtual from the time of the consultation until we file, so by phone, email, literally just sending us photos on their phone, that type of thing, but they also have more access to those mental health resources that the VAWA and the T-Visa clients really need.
Okay. And just how do you handle this growth? I mean, it's like growing 3 feet during a summer when you're a kid or something. It's gotta be painful.
Yeah. I mean, the first year was painful. It was awesome and exhilarating. But I was also pregnant at that time with my second kid and it was the middle of COVID and everyone was like not leaving their homes. So we moved across the country and it was a lot.
Oh my God. It's been a crazy couple years.
It was really crazy. I mean, I took like 2 weeks off after I had my kid and then I was like, all right, I have to get back to work because I just have to. But now we've settled more since then. We're still having great growth, but we have an amazing executive team now, which is something I never really envisioned, but we're running it like a business. So I now have more of a CEO role. I mean, I'm the CEO and I don't really interact that much with clients, except for since we're totally remote, we do pop-ups in different cities and I'll go to those sometimes. But we have a COO, Chief Operations Officer, who's like looking at the processes of the whole firm and has a whole team that's just making sure things
work. That lawyer or non-lawyer position?
Non-lawyer.
Good idea.
Yeah. And then we have a CFO, marketing director. We have an HR director. So it's this really high level team of people who honestly, all except for me and then my supervising attorney are the attorneys on this executive team, but everyone else comes from other industries. And so it's been really cool to have those interactions and those perspectives that you don't usually get in the legal field.
Yeah. How do you hire for those roles? Like, because it's the first time you're hiring, essentially. Do you have consultants, or how do you figure out who to hire, if they're good or not, and that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so when we were first hiring, the first major hires we did, so the COO is my husband, actually. I kind of poached him because I was like, I want your skill set. So I poached him first, and then after that, though, we used an agency, like a, you know, what are they called?
Recruiting or headhunter kind of
recruiting, thing. Recruiting, yeah, headhunting agency that we really liked called Hirewell. They're based in the Midwest somewhere, but they found us some really amazing candidates. So the first role we wanted was the HR director, because we were like, oh my gosh, yeah. Like, you know, we need help with this. And then we got a, she's now our chief of staff, but she came in to assist the COO in doing all of the strategy and the operations and things like that. So I guess her role originally is operations director, and she's moved up to chief of staff. But that company, like, they really helped us find some good people. And once we found them, our HR director is amazing. So she just helps with staffing constantly.
That's key. Yeah. As I'm growing and I'm minuscule compared to your firm, just HR stuff is like a whole thing where it's like, I can't wait to be big enough to hire. It's like, just
I mean, I originally started off with an HR person that I found through Upwork. Have you heard of Upwork? Yeah. So he was good, but it's like, everyone's totally remote, but he was in another country and it was like helpful, but not enough. And once I found like that key person, that just took a huge weight off my shoulders. Yeah. Like, I don't have to deal with it at all. I only interview if it's like, I think the last time I interviewed was for our marketing director position.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's really nice. So.
And I'm assuming you also use like international team members as well to help with different operation aspects.
Yeah, we actually we have people in a number of countries, but we actually opened an office in Costa Rica last September. And so we just marked our 1 year anniversary in that office. So I took my family down there for the summer. We lived there for the summer in Costa Rica and, you know, just visited that office, interacted with that team. But we have a whole team there, which is, it's really cool. Honestly, I hadn't been since. So when I went last September, we were just like putting the final touches on the office. There was no staff in there. And when I went this summer, I like teared up because I was kind of like, whoa, like when I started this firm on my couch, like I did not envision having this international office. And like, I don't know, it was really powerful to hear my team like talking to clients over the phone and like working on their cases. It was just a very cool experience.
It's incredible. It's incredible. I mean, like, did you plan on this size, or what was your, did you have a vision for it? It kind of just happened and you went with it.
Yeah. Like, I'm very comfortable with evolving and changing my plans, but I do distinctly remember my dad visiting me when we lived in Northern Virginia, DC area. And he asked me like, so like, what do you want to do with the firm? What do you expect? Do you think you're going to grow it? What do you think? And I told him, no, I like it how it is. I think I'm just going to have it be me and a paralegal, and I'll just work on cases. Like, I really love it like this. Yeah. And I don't know, that was probably 6 years, 7 years ago. And now here we are.
Yeah, life's incredible. It just takes you different directions.
Yeah. Yeah. But honestly, I couldn't be happier with the growth and the team we have. So looking back, like, I just feel like my brain just, it hadn't reached its capacity of like what was possible.
Yeah, incredible. So how do you keep track of all this? Do you have a dashboard with certain like KPIs that you track to make sure things are running? How do you just know things are operating right?
Yeah, we have a lot of different KPIs, spreadsheets, things like that. We use MyCase, and our operations team has built out a lot of features through MyCase to allow us to track a lot more data. But I think at this point we're planning to design our own software because we're too limited. Like, we really, because the firm is growing so fast and it's so big, and I have this executive team that comes from other industries, like they look at things differently than a traditional law firm. And they're like, okay, we need to track like this, 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 and this metric. Yeah. And the software that's been developed so far for law firms just really doesn't have that capacity. So right now we're tracking it in spreadsheets and things like that, but we will eventually build out our own software.
Do you have plans on hiring more attorneys, or just kind of just grows as it, is there like some like vision of where to be? Because even with 10 people in immigration law, you're one of the bigger law firms, because usually it's like 2 or 3 people in immigration.
Yeah. I mean, it will just keep growing kind of as needed. We do strategic planning for the firm every year. So we do kind of have a roadmap of where we want to go. I would say, you know, this upcoming year, our focus is more on technology and less on hiring more staff. We will hire more staff to supplement as needed, but we really want to take advantage of the technological opportunities that we can to make our firm more efficient. So that's where we're going to be investing more time and money this year. And I mean, I foresee in the next 5 to 10 years, you know, being like, I don't want to give out, you know, my, like my financial goals, but I expect to be like a very large firm.
Wonderful. And are you, do you think you're going to go into other areas of law or stick with immigration, or not sure yet?
Not sure yet, although I think we're going to stick with immigration. I would say like kind of a driving force behind our company culture is the passion and compassion that our team members really feel for the immigrant community. So it would be a hard pivot to bring in a different practice area. But one thing we're looking at is other like product offerings for the immigrant community. So like maybe we'll have a tax department. We're in the process of developing, and I think we're going to release it pretty soon, but English classes for our clients that want to naturalize. So things like that. So rather than looking at other areas of the law, we're looking at other services that we can provide our client base.
If you were on social media, what's like your biggest channel?
Facebook.
Yeah. One thing I've seen people who have large followings like on YouTube and stuff, they go towards having some other offering that's not pure immigration law, but because there's just so much volume of people are contacting, you probably need help.
Sorry, I didn't understand.
No, it's interesting when you have a large channel on social media. I've seen a lot of other firms who might have like 100,000 subscribers on YouTube and stuff. They create side projects. So we have one colleague who has how to, you know, fill out, do a U.S. resume or how to find a job in the U.S. There's all these ancillary kind of products that people really need. And if you got that much volume coming at you, then it becomes worthwhile to develop the product further.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I think it's kind of fun for our team to think about, okay, what is something creative that's not really being offered that we can offer? And like, how can we help people in a different way? Like our strategic planning sessions in the firm are like, they're a lot of work. We have one next week that's our like big annual one in DC for a full week. And I know by the end, I'm going to be dead. Yeah. But it's also really fun because it's amazing to just see like the business ideas and the, just the creative energy that goes into thinking about how can we help our clients? How can we grow the business? Like what are different things we can do that nobody else is doing?
Mm-hmm. I was fascinating. I'm so happy you guys, we got to connect and everything like that. There's a lot of questions I want to ask. A lot of it goes into the personal business stuff. So I, but if there was like, I would say one lesson, but you have probably full of lessons because of experience you've gotten, but for someone, and it's kind of a greedy question, but someone going through a path of having their first lawyer, second lawyer, wants to go to like 5 lawyers, what a piece of advice that you have to be able to handle what's about to happen or come up?
Yeah, that's a great question. And honestly, I coach attorneys, and this is something that comes up a lot. So the biggest thing I suggest is focus hard on your company culture, because as you grow, that's going to shape the way that your firm develops and the way your staff interacts with you and interacts with clients and interacts with each other. And if you have a clear vision for what your company culture should be, as you're bringing in new attorneys, you'll train them that way and you'll have kind of a model to follow. And that will, I mean, at least it has for me, that tends to almost lend itself to more growth. Mm-hmm. Like it just creates kind of a natural transition because people are a little more motivated because they just feel happier at work. Yeah. And then it's easier as a boss to manage those people because they've drunk the Kool-Aid essentially. Yeah. Like they're on board with your culture. They're a fit for the culture. And if they're not a fit for the culture, it becomes obvious pretty quickly.
Yeah. How have you developed the culture? Like, what was it? Did you have like courses or a mentor that helped you or something like that? Do you get consultants, I'm guessing, to help guide you on this path?
Yeah, we definitely do have consultants. At different phases, we've used different companies, different coaches, things like that. But as far as the culture goes, it's just something that, so in strategic planning, we definitely have outlined, you know, these are our like core pillars, our core values, this is our mission. And those are things we're bringing up all the time. But that doesn't totally go to culture. Like for me, I came from a firm before I started my own firm where I didn't feel like I could be open with my boss. I felt like I was gonna get in trouble or like, you know, I just didn't feel comfortable. And so ever since the beginning, I've tried really hard to foster respect in my firm. Like, come to me, I'm open. You can even tell me what I can do better, like what's not working. Yeah. Like, I will not get upset about that. And so as the firm has grown, I've taught my leaders to have the same type of interactions. And we've taught, you know, the newest person that comes to the team is taught, you know, you can talk to your manager. You can tell them if you're having a problem or if something's not working. Like, we want that. You can go to the CEO if you want and tell her this is not working, and she will tell you thank you. And I think just reinforcing that over and over in like our all hands meetings, which is the whole company, but our executive team meetings too. So it's just constantly filtering throughout the company.
Oh, fascinating. There's just a lot going on there. Please come on the show and again, and keep us posted on what's going on. You said you also mentor other lawyers. Is it like a formal thing or how does that work?
Yeah, I do formal coaching. So if you are interested, you can reach out to me. My email is lauren.egan@eganimmigration.com. But I take on it's one-on-one sessions where we're literally just working through your particular firm's needs or your particular career needs. And I'm just teaching you everything that I've learned along the way so that you don't have to figure it out on your own.
Definitely worth it. I'll have to hit you up myself. I really appreciate it, Lauren. Stay around for a couple minutes while I shut it off. But, okay. You know, thanks for coming. Are there social media channels where you talk like business to business outside the consumer angle?
We don't have any right now, although I will probably be opening one up for Egan Empowerment is my coaching company. That's the name of it. I've kept it really small up until now because I was like feeling out how many clients I wanted to take on, but I'm open to taking on more. So you'll see me popping up on social media.
Great. Keep posted. We'll tell everybody about it. Thanks so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome. It was great.